1 John 5:16. When any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. This morning, a request to you. Listen to the word of God carefully, and you have to give me a suitable caption, a title for today's message. I want to select the best title you are giving for today's message. Yesterday, a child of God phoned me, asked me to explain this verse. What is sin unto death, and what is sin not unto death? Why does the apostle say that I do not say that he shall pray for it? Why should not we pray for it? When I was helping that sister, I was reading this passage again and again, and I am bringing the Lord's word to you. One of the most difficult passages we find in the Bible, or I find in the Bible. So we go to verse 16. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. If any man see his brother sin a sin which is not unto death. Number one, I want to tell you from this passage, we all must have concern for the sinners. Here when we say, when you see your brother sins, so this brother may be the saved, or this brother may be the unsaved. If you go with me to Romans chapter 9 verse 1, Romans 9:1, Paul says, I say the truth in Christ, I lie not, my conscience also bearing me witness in the Holy Ghost, that I have great heaviness and continual sorrow in my heart, for I could wish that myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen, according to the flesh. He has got a great burden for his own kinsmen, his own brothers, sisters, relatives, according to flesh. They are not saved. They are not brought into this glorious truth. So when you see your brother sin, he is not saved. All unrighteousness is sin. He is without salvation. And his burden was, it is better that I could wish I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren. Though I preach on it, it is very difficult for me also to think that I would say it is better for me to get accursed from Christ. Accursed, separated from Christ for my brethren. Brother, sister, it's a challenge for you and I. Have you ever seen that burden in us? It is better that I become accursed from Christ. I become cursed from Christ for the sake of my kinsmen. In today, the gospel is very different from what it was in the days of the Paul. Paul was a rich man. He was a Pharisee. He had a Roman citizenship. And they say that he had a fleet of ships. And for the sake of mission, for the sake of ministry, He lived as a cursed person on the earth. That cursed life was a blessed life for him. He was beaten with lathis, stoned, he was in the shipwreck, he was naked, he was hungry, he starved. Why did he suffer like this? These are the symptoms of a cursed person. He was beaten up. He was put in prison. He became accursed. Jesus was not giving a very good protection around him. Today we see we are blessed. When I came for the ministry, I got a cycle. Now I got a car, I am blessed. When I came for the ministry, before that I was starving. Now I got 3 square meals, I am blessed. But in Paul's case, it was different. He was cursed. He had a life as an accursed person. Starving, beaten up, naked, stoned, lathi-charged. Why? For the sake of the gospel, glorious gospel of Christ. When we see somebody sin, have we got that burden? We accuse sinners. In our work spot, in the midst of our relatives, we see so many people sin. All unrighteousness is sin. But what do you do with a sinner? When you see a sinner, what do you do? Do we criticize him? Or we want to separate ourselves from that sinner? Because Jesus separated himself from sinners. So we want to separate ourselves from sinners. What do we do for them? Or we just go and preach? We try to evangelize them? When I was reading this passage, the Bible says, when you see a sinner, pray for the sinner. If any man seek his brother's sinner's sin, which is not unto death, he shall ask. You shall pray. Ask God to save that sinner. Sinners are all around us. So number one, when I say brother, is a brother who is not saved. And also, the term brother speaks about somebody who has received Jesus Christ, yet he sins. Many years back, when a servant of God, a very senior pastor, a father in Chennai Christianity, when he was talking to me, I asked him, we have got so many strategies, so many projects, so many plans to reach the unreached with this gospel. We don't want them to go to hell. But the Bible says all liars will go to hell. All liars will go to hell. Those who are with us in the church, those who are with us in the ministry, those who are with us in the pastor's fellowship. Pastor, don't you know anybody who lies? He said, yes, I know many people. Don't you know any servant of God who lies? He said, yes, I know. Pastor, what is the strategy you have got to save these pastors, to save these believers, not to go to hell? If we cannot love the people whom we see, how will we love the people whom we don't see? We say that we have got a great concern for those who are living in forests, those who are living in tribes, those who are worshipping idols. We don't want them to go to hell. It's good. It's good. But when we know the people whom we know, they are going to hell. They are head first to hell. They are merchandising with ministry. They are speaking lies. They are writing false accounts. The false balance is abomination to God. But what we do about them? When you know a believer lies, brother, sister, somebody who participates with you the Lord's Supper, somebody probably who teaches you the word of God, somebody who is known all over the world, a TV evangelist, in your church, in your family, a believer, if he sins, John 3:16 is misunderstood. One of the verses which is misunderstood and misquoted by the Christians and mostly by the evangelists. Please, if you have got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with me to John 3:16. Please, I want you to see and read. I want you to see and read John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Please listen. He gave his only begotten son that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. The corollary, one who believes in him can also perish. He didn't die on the cross for somebody, not only for somebody who doesn't believe in him. Here he talks about, this verse talks about somebody who believes in him. And in English grammar, there's a difference between whosoever and whomsoever. It is not whomsoever, it is whosoever. Whosoever it may be, pastor or a believer, musician or a singer, preacher or the interpreter, preaching in the church or preaching in the street, rich or poor, illiterate or an erudite, whosoever it may be, if you believe in him, you should not perish but have everlasting life. He has concern for the believers. And if you read that whole passage, you'll understand. Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, not for the people who were in Egypt, but for the people who crossed the Red Sea. Please listen. Moses lifted up a serpent in the wilderness for the salvation of the people. Not those who are in Egypt, but those who are brought out of Egypt, those who crossed the Red Sea, those who are led by the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud, those who ate manna, those who drank water from the rock, they perished in the wilderness. They came out of Egypt by the blood of the Passover lamb. When you're baptized, you cross the Red Sea. You are led by the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud. He feeds you with his manna. He quenches your thirst with the water from the rock. But you can perish. Jesus was lifted up on the cross, not only for the sinner, but for the saved sinner. Today we are in a self-deception that once we are saved, saved. Forever. No. He that endureth till the end shall be saved. People are after money. People are after lust, adultery. My dear brother, my dear sister, hell is not going to be only for the non-Christians. So when you see a brother sins, pray. Pray. Otherwise, their dead bodies were strewn in wilderness. Out of nearly 6 lakhs men and women, children, they say about 30 lakhs two people were able to inherit the promised land. See the ratio. 2 out of 30 legs. 1 out of 15 legs. 1 out of 15 legs. 14 legs. 99,999 people perished, one saved. 14 lakhs. 99,999 people, saved people, perished for one saved person saved. And Paul says, it is written for our admonishing, for our lesson, for to have a lesson from that. God is not well pleased with all those who are saved. I have to perfect my salvation with fear and trembling. He that has got an ear to hear, let him hear. I tell you the truth, a plain truth. So we must have concern for a sinner, whether a saved sinner or an unsaved sinner. The only difference, for a saved sinner, salvation is very near. Salvation is very near. But hell is the same for all the sinners. There is no special compartment in hell for the saved sinners and the unsaved sinners. If you see any brother sin a sin, you ought to pray for that brother. We must have concern for sinners, and we have to be careful about our life. Let me go quickly to number 2, verse 14. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. Number 2. Number 1, concern for the sinner. Number 2, confidence in our Savior. Confidence in our Savior. And this is the confidence that we have in him, in our Savior, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. My dear brother, my dear sister, we are praying for a sinner or praying for anything else. The very basis for our prayer is our confidence in him. That's what we saw in verse 13. These things have I written unto you, that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. If you believe in the name of the Son of God, faith is a wonderful thing. Faith gives confidence. When we believe in the name of the Son of God, we have got confidence. So you ask anything, the Lord will give you. He had a wonderful testimony. She asked for a job. The Lord gave her a job. Apply it. You ask for the salvation of a sinner, the Lord will answer your prayer. How many of you believe it? Say, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Please listen. This sermon will give you answer for some of your questions. You have got the confidence. When you pray for a sinner, the Lord will grant your prayer. You ask the nations, I will give you. So when we ask for, yet he will not give us a stone. When we ask for a fish, he will not give us a serpent. When we ask for bread, he will not give us a stone. When we ask our Heavenly Father, he will give us good things. When we ask for the salvation of a sinner, he will not say no to that prayer. we have got that confidence when we believe in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. This afternoon we are going to have a skit by our TTC members about George Mueller. George Mueller was praying for some of his friends, I think 3 or 5 people. The Lord answered all his prayer, but he could not see the salvation of one of those boys, one of his friends, till his death. But I think that man also got saved at the funeral of George Mueller, or at his cemetery. Our prayers will be answered. Prayers are answered. Wait. You may have a question. There are prayers which we don't see an answer. We'll see what the Bible talks about it. My dear brother, my dear sister. So we have got the confidence when we believe in the name of Jesus, the Son of God. And when we have concern for the sinners who sin, whether the saved sinners or the unsaved sinners, we have got a confidence that our prayer will be answered. And this is a confidence that we have in Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He heareth us. The salvation of a sinner is according to His will. It's not the will of God that anyone should perish. It's the will of God that all should get saved. So when we pray for the salvation of a sinner, it is according to His will. So when we have the concern for the sinner, and when we are confident in our Savior, then He talks about a comfort of the success. A comfort of the success. Verse 15. And if we know that He hears us whatsoever we ask, we know that we have received the petitions that we desire of Him. My dear brother, my dear sister, as I'm sharing the word of God, I'm very conscious. A question, a very sincere brother with a broken heart posed to me. Pastor, this is what Bible says. I know this is in the Bible. If we ask anything whatsoever. Okay, whatsoever according to His will, we know that we have the petition that we desired of Him. We receive the answer of what we ask, but sometimes it doesn't work out. Please listen, my dear brother, my dear sister. The greatest comfort is not in receiving, it is in believing that you receive. It seems to be paradoxical. I remember many times I told you, once we just put it on a writing also. Faith is not receiving what we believe. Faith is believing what God can do. Abraham believed that God will give him a city without foundation. He died in faith without receiving what he believed. In today's evangelists teach a different gospel. If you believe, you'll receive. Abraham believed. He's the father of faith. But he didn't receive what he believed. He never seen the city without foundations. But he believed in. He saw that afar. He embraced it. He hugged it. When it was not there, how did he hug it? It was not there, he hugged it. He died in faith. Isn't Isaac? He saw his father believe, but not received it. But he continued to believe that there will be a city without foundation. It will descend from God. He believed in faith. He didn't receive. He died in faith without receiving what his father believed, what he believed. He had two sons, Esau and Jacob. Jacob was with Abraham for 15 years. Esau with Abraham for 15 years. They have seen their grandpa always talking about a city without foundation, but never received it. He just said, I am hugging it. It was only a virtual belief, not an actual belief for these boys. And to that great astonishment, their father Isaac, as their grandfather, believed something which they never seen. At one point, the eldest boy said, stop all this nonsense. I always say, grandpa talking about a city without foundation, he never received it, he died in faith. Daddy, now your eyes are blind and your spiritual eyes are also blind. You are always talking about a city without foundation. We are not going to receive it anytime. I don't want to be a tent dweller. See the Canaanites. Are they cursed? Are they not building in houses? Are they not building their own houses? Are they mad people? Are they not successful? Why do you want to live in a tent? Say, God will give a city, God will give a city. Is it not enough that your father was deceived by all these faith sayings? So Esau was very rational. Esau was very logical. Esau was very intelligent. He had a reason for his logic. Grandpa believed. He didn't receive it. Daddy, 70 years I've seen you saying, city, a city, a city. Say these people, why should we be alien to them? Why we want to know we are separated from you? They are hating us. Why can't we be one with them? Why can't we marry their daughters? They are also human beings with two eyes, two legs, two ears. Why can't we be one with them? Why want to show that we are different? 100% logically, rationally, Esau was not wrong. He made his choice. That grieved the heart of Isaac. That grieved the heart of Rebecca. We believe God will give us a house that is not built with our hands. We shall live in tent till that time. No! That's absolute nonsense. That's an irrational theology. Why should we live in a tent when we can build a house? Why should we be separated from the Canaanites? Why can't we mix with them? Why can't we live with them? Why can't we show our relationship to them? But these are wrong. In a worldly yardstick, Esau was not wrong. But if you agree with me, to a biblical yardstick, Esau made a tremendous mistake. The gospel of Esau, the gospel of Jacob, are two gospels what you see today. Whether we can build a house, live with as others live, be happy. It's one good news. One good news. Even if you live in a tent, live in faith. There are two gospels. One is the gospel according to the line of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob. 70 years. Jacob saw his grandpa for 15 years. And he has seen his father for 55 years. But he decided, I will worship the one who is the fear and reverence of my father, Isaac. So here we have got the comfort of success. Whatever we ask of him, we have what we desire. Not actually possessing it. See the language. Whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desired of him. We have that answer. We possess that answer. In the physical sense, we possess when we receive. In the spiritual sense, we possess when we believe. We receive and possess in the physical sense. In the spiritual sense, we possess and receive. If I put it in a simpler term, we possess what we receive. When you receive 1 lakh rupee, you possess it. You possess what you receive. In the spiritual sense, you receive what you already possess. Because what we don't see is more real than what we see. In the physical world, what we see is more real than what we don't see. In a metaphysical realm, what we don't see is more real than what we see. It's not philosophic, but if it is philosophic, we talk the wisdom of God to the philosophers. You all see me. It is real. You all see me, it is real. But the very presence of God is more real than the presence of Robert Simon. The presence of God we don't see, but that's more real than the presence of a preacher you see. So this is the greatest joy that we have. We possess that we desired of him. My dear brother, my dear sister, please wait for a few minutes. The Lord loves you. And it was very difficult last evening for me. Though I understand it is in my spirit, I could not understand it fully in my soul. And even when I was trying to transmit what I understand in my spirit to my soul, it was a very difficult spiritual exercise. The Spirit of the Lord was helping me. And another struggle, how I am going to transmit to the people, the Lord will help you. Number 4, condition for our supplication. Condition for our supplication. Number 1, concern for sinners. Number 2, confidence of the Savior. Confidence in the Savior. Number 3, comfort of the success. We possess what we desired of him. What we desired of him. Number 4, condition for our supplication. Condition for our supplication. 1 John 5:14. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. If you ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. You may say, I pray for the salvation of my father who is not saved. It's according to his will. I pray for the salvation of my brother, my mother. It is according to his will. So I'm praying for something that's according to his will. I'm not just praying something contrary to his will. So condition for our supplication is praying according to his will. Now praying according to his will is amplified in verse 16, a verse that is much misunderstood. If you still find it difficult to understand that passage, surely the Spirit of the Lord will help you. Not my intelligence, not my eloquence. I lack much in both. But I do believe the Spirit of the Lord will help you understand. And if you love to chat with me later, you please meet me, we can discuss. Verse 16 amplifies the will of God. If any man see his brother in a sin which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death. There is a sin unto death. I do not say that he shall pray for it. Here we read two verses, sin unto death, two phrases, sin unto death, sin not unto death, sin not unto death. If it is a sin not unto death, then pray for him. If it is sin unto death, I am not asking you to pray for it. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death. 1 John 5:17. All righteousness is sin. All unrighteousness is sin. The wages of sin is death. Galatians 3:10, second part. It is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. It's a sin. What is sin unto death? And what is sin not unto death? Please listen carefully. This phrase says, sin that tends to death. Sin that tends to death. It was a phrase used both in a legalistic way and also in a Judaistic way. We should understand the background. The people of the rabbis, they classified sin in two categories, sin unto death and sin not unto death. In the Old Testament, suppose somebody murders a person, a cold-blooded, well-plotted, premeditated, merciless murder. Raping a girl, plucking her eyes, nailing her to a tree, horrible murder, pushing an iron rod into a secret parts. Please bear with me. Somebody goes to the court. No, please leave him. Please don't put him to death. Okay, it's over. Out of lust he has done it. Everybody has got a beastly nature in us and it was little excess in him. Will the society accept? Can there be a property, a sin offering for him and say, okay, your sins are forgiven, go in peace, man? So to have a system in the society, eyes for eyes, hand for hand, life for life. So this man murdered somebody, raped an innocent victim, plucked her eyes, nailed her to the cross, made her naked, so many things. Nauseatic. Bear with me to say this from the pulpit. So somebody say, okay, it's okay. Just we kill an oxen. Okay, instead of 10, one oxen, we'll keep 10 oxen. Release him. No, that was a sin unto death. So in the Old Testament, that was a punishment is for him is death. I can't do anything to release him. Sin unto death. Sin leads him to death. I can go on like that, many sins. Here John says, you cannot pray to release him. Now please listen carefully. So when he was in an alien land, when somebody has sinned unto death, he cannot plead for that person to release from that situation. That's an Old Testament concept. It was more legalistic. We love sinners, but we can't love sin. We can't love sin. We can't change the system. My dear brother, my dear sister, when they brought a woman in adultery, Jesus never said, don't stone her. Jesus didn't pray for her. Jesus didn't say, condone her. We don't see Jesus pleaded for her. Did Jesus tell those magistrates, leave her? Did Jesus say, don't stone her? Jesus said, stone her. Please listen, Jesus said, stone her. Jesus said, who has to give the judgment? One who is without sin. Jesus didn't say, don't stone her. Jesus said, stone her. One who is without sin. Then why didn't he stone her? He was without sin. He should have stoned her. Is out of mercy Jesus didn't stone her, or out of justice Jesus didn't stone her? Jesus didn't stone her out of mercy. Jesus didn't stone her out of justice. Because it was justice, only the first eyewitness must stone her, and he was not an eyewitness for her adultery. He didn't stone her. Legally, Jesus didn't have a right to stone her because Jesus had never seen her with his physical eyes in adultery. He didn't break the law. He didn't break the law. He can't stone her. He has never seen her in adultery as a man. He didn't say, don't stone her. He didn't plead for her. My dear brother, my dear sister. Number two, this is the most important thing. With our prayer, with our supplication, we believe God can save a sinner. But please listen, please listen. With your prayer, you cannot change the will of a man. With your prayer, you cannot change the will of a man. Even then, God cannot change our free will. If I don't want to get saved, God cannot do anything. Through magic, God cannot save me. God can provide all opportunities for me to accept his grace. In Titus, the Bible says, the grace that saves all men appeared unto all. The grace that saves all men appeared unto all on the cross. There were Pharisees, there were priests, there were members of Sanhedrin, there were people of Jerusalem, there were Jews who came to Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, there were Roman soldiers, there were many people around the cross. The grace that can save all people appeared unto all people. But only one malefactor got saved. Please listen. That grace was available to the Pharisees. That grace was available to the members of Sanhedrin. That grace was available to the Roman soldiers. That grace was available to the people of Jerusalem. That grace was available to all those who came there to celebrate the Passover. But all were not saved when they saw Jesus on the cross of Calvary. Only one malefactor changed. That grace could not influence the free will of the other malefactor. That grace was unable to influence Anna and Caiaphas. That grace was unable to influence the free will of Pilate. That grace was unable to influence all those who shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" That grace was only able to change one malefactor. Whether you are morally good or not, when you or anybody shuts their heart to the gospel and God can't do anything, you and I can do nothing. Nevertheless, we pray that salvation is near to them. And we can't come to it. I'll tell you that point later. Jeremiah 14:11. God said, "Then said the Lord unto me, unto Jeremiah, pray not for this people, for their good." Don't pray for their good. Jesus didn't pray for Pilate. Pray for all those who are in authority. Jesus said, "Forgive them. They know not what they do." When Pilate could shut his heart, I always say, the prayer Jesus prayed on the cross, we can't say in verbatim, it touched everybody. Can you say Pilate? In the history, we don't say Pilate got saved. In the history, we don't see Ananias got saved. In the history, we don't read Herod got saved. They all saw Jesus personally. They didn't know what they were doing. Jesus said, "Forgive them." But were they saved? Though they had a personal encounter with Jesus, brother, sister, in one place the Lord tells Jeremiah, "Pray not for this people for their good." Jeremiah 15:1. "Then said the Lord, though Moses and Samuel stood before me," two people praying together, Moses and Samuel stood before me, "yet my mind could not be toward this people. Cast them out of my sight and let them go forth." My dear brother, my dear sister, last night that broke my heart. What more I can do? The Spirit of the Lord wanted me to read verse 16 again. Compassion to impart salvation. Compassion to impart salvation. "If any man see his brother sin a sin, which is not unto death, he shall ask, and he shall give him life for them that sin not unto death." Who shall give him? God or one who prays? The man who prays or God? He shall give him life, life to that sinner. They sin not unto death. My dear brother, my dear sister, Hebrews 10:26, I read, "For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for a judgment and a fiery indignation which shall devour the adversaries. After salvation, after tasted heaven, after received the Holy Spirit, after saved by the blood of the Lamb, if somebody willfully sins, Jesus cannot die for them again. They are doomed for eternal death. We can't do anything. We can't do anything. But here the Bible says, if you see any man sin, which is not unto death, you pray. Now how do I decide whether somebody is sinning unto death or sinning not unto death? I just read to you what Matthew Henry says. We cannot pray that the sins of the impenitent and unbelieving should, while they are such, be forgiven them. Somebody is impenitent. They don't repent. They don't accept the truth. Now, we cannot say, Lord, take them into heaven. Here Henry says, we cannot pray that the sins of the impenitent and unbelieving should, while they are such, while they continue to be in their sin, be forgiven them. When they are totally impenitent, we cannot tell the Lord, forgive them. Or that any mercy of life or soul that suppose the forgiveness of sin should be granted to them while they continue such. He continues drinking. He continues worshipping idols. Lord, forgive him. He is worshipping idol, forgive him. Lord, he is drinking, forgive him. When he is impenitent, when he continues in idolatry, when he continues in adultery, when he continues in his sin, we cannot say, Lord, forgive him his sins. Even when we say forgive him his sins, unless he repents, his sins are not going to be forgiven. But we may pray for their repentance. We pray for their repentance, supposing them, but in the common case of the impenitent world, for their being enriched with faith in Christ. Lord, somehow open their eyes for faith. Lord, give him a heart of penitent. Let him feel sorry for the way he is going. Turn his heart towards you, O Lord. We can continue to pray, and thereupon for all other saving mercies. So our prayer, when we pray for the salvation of the sinner, it is for the sinner to come out. What happens? Please listen. When he doesn't sin unto death, when he repents, he is not listed to go to hell. You can see the answer by your prayer. So you don't judge. It is a sin unto death, it is not a sin unto death. Till you got confidence, you pray for that person. A word of consolation. Even when we see that person dies in his sin, we cannot give a judgment. In that last minute, in that last second, he must have cried. He must have cried, Father, remember me in your kingdom. Salvation is the Lord's. We cannot sit on judgment. We continue to pray. Don't pray, my husband should come to the church. What's the use of a drunkard coming to the church and continue to be a drunkard? wages of all sin is death. The rabbi said certain things are sin unto death, certain things are not sin unto death. But spiritually all unrighteousness is sin. And he says in verse 17, verse 17 is very powerful. All unrighteousness is sin, but sin not unto death. Every sin may be unto death, but even Jesus died on the cross for the worst sinner that he can be delivered. But neither your prayer nor God himself can change or influence the free will of a person. When he decides not to choose this way, when he decides not to give up idolatry, when he decides not to come out of sin, a prayer cannot change anybody. My dear brother, my dear sister, 2 Timothy chapter 2 verse 24, and the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Brother, sister, compassion for the deliverance of the people. They are in the snare of the devil. As you are the servant of the Lord, don't strive, don't argue with them, don't find fault with them, don't accuse them, don't condemn them, don't criticize them. When you see a brother sin, don't strive, but be gentle. Be gentle unto that sinner. Maybe a father, a mother, a brother, a sister, another believer, a servant of God, whosoever it may be. Be gentle. Be apt to teach. Explain to them. They are not listening to you. Be patient. In meekness, instruct them. They are opposing you. Tell them with love and affection. Continue to speak to them with your meekness. If God peradventure, we may not know, will give them repentance, will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. We may not know. Today they may have a strong will against the truth. The love of God can break their heart tomorrow. We don't know. Continue to love them, to talk to them, be patient with them, instruct them, teach them, and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. They may come out. You don't give up. You don't give up. They may come out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. Devil has taken them into captivity. They are in idolatry. They are in adultery. They are opposing this glorious gospel. Their eyes are blinded. They are dead in their iniquity. You don't sit upon a judgment and say, okay, you are sinning unto death. All unrighteousness is sin. The wages of sin is death. My dear brother, my dear sister, you continue to pray for them. You love them. You talk to them. You never give up. Be patient. Don't strive. Don't argue. Don't accuse. Don't sit on a pedestal that you are a very holy, holy cow and they all are dirty pigs. Don't have that attitude. Love them. Be filled with love. Love of Jesus. Talk to them. Pray for them. They are opposing you. They don't acknowledge the truth you are sharing with them. Never give up. Pray. Intercede for them. You stand before God. Unless or otherwise God tells you, don't pray for them. I tell you one illustration that happened. It comes to my mind many years back, the time that I got saved. It comes to my mind, I'm saying a terrible thing. The Lord made me fast and pray 7 days for the people in the place where I was living in. 7 days I fasted and prayed, remembering every house in that place, sprinkling the blood of Jesus in every house and prayed. Whenever I was praying for a particular house, I don't know the people much in that house. It's a very strange experience. Whenever I was praying for a particular house, somehow I was not very comfortable to pray for that. But anyway, I said, praise the Lord, and I moved on. It so happened, I never planned like that. On the 7th day, I prayed for 7 times. For every house in that locality, just remembering that house. When I came to that particular house, in the very first round, the Lord told me not to pray for that house. Not to pray for that man in that house. I just skipped. I prayed for every house. In that place, on that day, there was no Pentecostal church. There were a few brothers who received the truth, and we were going to Avati, Apatabiram. Today, that's a Christian community. So on that day, I prayed for all the houses 7 times. The very next day, suddenly around 6 o'clock, as if the hell is let loose against me, a type of darkness came upon me. I could not pray, I could not praise. I mean, as if somebody was pulling me to hell. It was a terrible struggle. I cried. I prayed in the spirit. Suddenly I had a deliverance. I was praising God. And a neighbor came to me and said, Sir Terima, so-and-so died a few minutes back. It was a rude shock. The man in that house died. The Lord didn't allow me to pray for him. I didn't know him personally. But an incident that I cannot forget in my life. With all fear and trembling, I tell you. The Spirit of the Lord is speaking to you. Through your prayer, you can bring the salvation of God to somebody closer to him. You can bring God to him, but somebody to God. It's only he has to open his heart. Pray. It's a mystery. The Lord should have grace to open his heart also. Brother, sister, never give up. Fill your heart with your love. Continue to intercede. Salvation is the Lord's. Shall we close our eyes? I remind you my request. Give a title for this sermon. When you see a sinner sin, believer or unbeliever, pray for him. salvation is the Lord's. There are sin unto death. They sin and they tend to go to hellfire. There are sin not unto death. They can repent and be saved. A prayer can give them life. Dear Father God, give me a heart to pray for the people and I see them sin, O Lord. It's not just preaching, O Master God. Give me a heart filled with your love to be patient with them. Those who oppose this glorious gospel, those who could not acknowledge this truth, to talk to them, to intercede for them. Give me a heart filled with your love, interceding for them day in, day out. Bless your people, O Lord. Create a heart in them that would always uphold sinners at the throne of your mercy. Those who want to have a heart filled with love for the sinners, lift your hands towards him and just a word of prayer. Give me a heart filled with love for the sinners. Just lift your hand up and ask him. A heart that's filled with love for sinners, filled with love for sinners, not to condemn them, not to criticize them, a heart that gives life to them. Lord, grant unto your people that desire. They desire a heart that can love sinners and to intercede, implore, pray for the sinners. Create that heart in every one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.